Well, if you've got your Bible, turn to the book of Luke, Luke chapter 10. You know, I want to introduce this message this morning, and I want to take us back as you're turning there to Luke chapter 10. We're going to look at verse 25 and following. But a few months ago when we started the series, Speak Faith, the Future is Now. How many of you remember that series, Speak Faith, the Future is Now? When we began that series, I told you there were going to be some things coming your way that I was going to share with you about the future of the church. I was going to share vision with you. And this morning is that moment. There are things that I'm going to share with you this morning that God has been speaking to me about and speaking to the staff. I've talked to the deacons about some of these things. And he's been doing this for about 18 months now. And as we get to the end of this message, I'm going to introduce some of those things to you and share that with you. And that's all I'm going to say about that. So if you've got Luke chapter 10, stand up and let's read God's word. Amen. Luke chapter 10, verse 25, and I'm going to finish it at verse 37. Bible says that one day an expert in religious law, this is a lawyer in religious studies, if you will, he stood up to test Jesus by asking him this question. Teacher, what should I do to inherit eternal life? Jesus replied, well, what does the law of Moses say? How do you read it? The man answered, you must love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your strength, and all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. Right, Jesus told him. Do this and you will live. But the man wanted to justify his actions, so he asked Jesus, and who is my neighbor? Jesus replied with a story. A Jewish man was traveling from Jerusalem down to Jericho, and he was attacked by bandits. They stripped him of his clothes, beat him up, and left him half dead beside the road. By chance, a priest came along. But when he saw the man lying there, he crossed to the other side of the road and passed him by. A temple assistant walked over and looked at him lying there, but he also passed by on the other side. Then, a despised Samaritan, say that with me, despised Samaritan. Now let's all say it. Despised Samaritan. He came along, and when he saw the man, he felt compassion for him. Going over him to him, the Samaritans, he soothed his wounds with olive oil and wine and bandaged them. And then he put the man on his own donkey and took him to an inn where he took care of him. The next day he handed the innkeeper 2 silver coins, telling him, take care of this man. If this bill runs higher than this, I'll pay you the next time I'm here. Now, which of these would you say was a neighbor to the man who was attacked by bandits? Jesus asked. The man replied, the one who showed him mercy. And then Jesus said, yes, now go and do the same. Pray with me one more time. Jesus, open our ears that we'd hear your voice this morning. Open our eyes to see this morning what the Spirit would have us to see and hear. And God, may I be a conduit for you to move through. Put a filter over my mouth that I'd only say what you want me to say. In Jesus' name, amen. You can be seated. The whole context and setting of this story, of our message this morning, is in response to this religious lawyer. So as we begin to unpack the text this morning, you need to understand the whole point of the story of the Good Samaritan was in response to a religious lawyer who stood up to test Jesus. Now, I can remember a time in my life back in 2003. Now, some of you know my testimony. Some of you know that I got saved in a jail cell when I was looking at about 40-some years in prison. I was a drug addict. I was a drug dealer. I had been arrested multiple times. But it was May of 2003, when I went in for my final sentencing, and I'd made a plea deal with the judge, and I was going to plead guilty to one, they were going to drop another, they were going to finally give me 10 years in jail. I was also going to be allowed to go to Teen Challenge, and once I finished Teen Challenge, I'd come back and finish my time in jail. But this particular day in the courtroom, there was a lawyer there. And this lawyer was the assistant prosecuting attorney, and it wasn't the guy that was there when we made the deal. Now, this particular lawyer stood up that day, and he began to test the judge. He began to test the judge's decision, and he began to pull out everything that he could pull out, everything that he knew. Judge, I've got files on my desk this high of guys who have done less than him, and they're going to get more time in jail. We've got all of this evidence against him, and we've got all of these charges against him. Why in the world are we sending him to Teen Challenge? Why isn't he going to prison for much longer? And he was just going in, and my heart fell out of my chest. I about fell out of my seat because I thought it was a done deal. I thought I was going to go to Teen Challenge. I was only getting 10 years. I thought it was going to be like this, but this attorney, this lawyer, man, he was on fire. And then all of a sudden, as some of you know because you've heard me share this story, the judge just speaks up and he just puts the lawyer in his place and he just sets him up and he says, you didn't have nothing to do with this. We've made a decision. This is what's going to happen. And then my heart kind of slowly but surely got back in my chest. You know, this is what's going to happen that day. But I just thought it was interesting as I read this story because I was familiar with a lawyer that would stand up to test somebody. Now, framing everything that we're doing, framing everything that you're going to hear, this lawyer seems to know things. He seems to have a handle on the scriptures. The Bible describes this man as an expert in religious law. And the one who's an expert stands up to test Jesus. Jesus, you know, the name of Jesus, the one we sing about this. He's going to test Jesus. Now, this lawyer, the debater, the strategist, you know, lawyers can find a loophole just about anywhere. They can find a way to make their case. And this expert in religious law, he stands up to try to make his case. The Bible uses the word justify. His whole intent by standing up to test Jesus was to justify his living, justify his case. He wanted to make it clear that I need to get off the hook here. Something about this religious man, something about this religious lawyer wasn't quite right, and so he needed to try to soothe things over in his heart. And I tend to think that there's a reason why. Because when I think about loving my neighbor, it may disrupt my way of doing things. Come on, if you really love your neighbor, as the Bible is going to show us here when we unpack this, it may mean you're going to have to change some things about how you go and do. Right? As you begin to love your neighbor like Jesus shows us in this story, I may have to address my selfish nature. My on the go, do my thing, worry about me and my three, care about my four and no more, right? Come on, you with me? Because that's what's happening. A religious priest sees him, crosses the road and goes to the other side. Temple assistant comes over, takes a good look, he goes to the other side. And so caring and loving my neighbor means it may disrupt my normal day-to-day living. And I just want to pause and reflect. Because how often do we find the lawyer in us? How often are we this guy that wants to stand up and make our case? How often do we want to stand up and justify our way of doing things, and we justify our way of doing things while using the scripture? Right, this man stood up and he quoted the greatest commandment, and then he quoted the second commandment. He gave the big dogs to Jesus. Love the Lord your God with all of your heart, mind, soul, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. He didn't just go to the little dogs. He went to the big dogs. I like big dogs. I love my little furry chocolate labs, hairy chocolate labs. We were debating this the other day. He's wanting to justify, right? Because I think there's something about religious that's like a time clock, right? The self-righteous, I clock in, I clock out. And when I ask myself, Dusty, is there any of this man in you? Do you just come check in, check out? Is your religion a check in, check out kind of thing? Or am I always on duty? Right? The religious priest in the temple, did he check in, check out? Did he see, I'm not on duty today? Check in, check out. You with me? Right? Or do we become the to-do list, right? I got to get there to my Sunday school class, and I got to be on time. I got to at least ask one question to participate. I got to get there in the sanctuary. I've got to pay my tithes today. I've at least got to raise my hand or clap once during the songs to demonstrate to my wife that I'm participating and I'm not apathetic or complacent thinking about the football game. I am engaged. Right, clock in, clock out, I'm listening to the message. I may even pull out my phone and write down something that speaks to me. Come on, y'all act like you ain't ever done any of this stuff. Come on, there's a little lawyer in all of us if we're honest. So it's the write it down, check it off. I got to serve once a month. I come and I'll be an usher. I'll come and I'll greet somebody at the door. But you know what? We can be a little justifier just like the lawyer was doing, wanting to justify his case. But I want you to hear this morning, because the immediate problem here is not that the lawyer had a question. It's not that he had a question. It's not that he stood up to ask the question. But it's in his heart. See, it's in his heart, because this attempt was to justify his own way of doing things. The whole question wasn't because he wanted to go deeper in his faith. The whole question wasn't because he really wanted Jesus to expound upon that text. No. This was an attempt to justify his own way of doing things. Now, this is where it gets really personal. Because we are good. Come on, church. We are good at justifying our own way of doing things. We have a way that we like to do things. And if I just talk church for a minute, we have a way that we like church to go. We don't like church to be disrupted from the way that we like it to go. We don't want things to be out of place. We don't want somebody in my seat. Come on. Y'all have been around long enough to know. I'm preaching to the choir, but I'm just preaching it again. You know. But I'm saying, we don't like certain things to be moved, right? We just like it a certain way. And so the immediate problem here is not that the lawyer had a question, but it was that he wanted to test Jesus in an attempt to justify his own way. Now, I could go in on this for a little bit, but it's really not the heart of the message today. Because I've seen many stand up to test the leader, test it because they really liked it their way, and so they're hoping to test in such a way to continue to get their own way. That's all I'm going to say about all that. I'm going to move on. But the matter is a matter of heart. And so Jesus tells a story. So he catches what the man's doing. He catches what's taking place, because most people superficially would have heard, love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, and love your neighbor. So you got it, brother. Go on about your way. You have got it figured out. But Jesus saw something different. Jesus recognized an issue in the heart, because Jesus knew people. Jesus was always speaking to the heart. Jesus always got beyond the Sunday smile. Jesus always got behind the friendly handshake, the friendly let me serve, check it off, check it down, write it down, whatever you want to do there. Jesus could see past it. And you can't forget, as I continue here, that this story was given to us not just because Jesus wanted to talk about loving your neighbor, but it was because a religious lawyer didn't get it right. This story, when you talk about and do a Bible study, who is the audience? The audience was one man, a lawyer, a religious lawyer, an expert in religious law. And so keep that in mind, that this lawyer, this letter of the law kind of guy, is the one the story is prompted by. And so I just remind you textually as we look at this, as you get a little, you know, expository preaching here, that the point of the story is really to reveal the heart of the matter. I see it as exposing bad theology. It's clarifying who our neighbor really is. Because we like the neighbor that does things the way we want it to go, right? If you are a keep your yard up kind of guy, you like the neighbor that keeps their yard up. You don't like the neighbor who lets the grass get 6 feet high, right? You don't like that. There's things that we like to put our own preferences, there we go, on our neighbors. So Jesus is clarifying who the neighbor is. He wants us to understand what loving our neighbor looks like and what compassion really looks like. Now, last week, how many remember what I preached on? Anybody remember what the title of the message was? The flavor of culture. You all remembered. I'm so thankful this morning. And we talked about the salt and the light. Everybody was just waiting. You just wanted to yell it out, right? So I talked about the flavor of culture. We preached on the salt and the light. And we talked about how the body of Christ, we believers, are to be the salt and the light. We are to flavor our communities. And we don't take our cues from social media. We don't take our cues from the media, right? We are believers, and we are to flavor the culture around us. Now, you remember, you all remember this, that Jesus makes a comment about salt. And he said, what good is salt if it loses its flavor, right? It's no good. You throw it out and it to be trampled under feet, right? And I talked to you about the salt and the light is the Christian's witness, right? It puts us on display, because when he talked about the light, he said, you don't go hide a light under a basket. No, but we, the people who are the light of the world, should be like a city set up on a hill. We are witnesses to something greater than ourselves. But when we begin to lose our witness, we are flavorless Christians. We are bland. We are not tasty. We are not seasoning the world around us. And too many of us are standing silent on the sidelines, failing to flavor the culture around us. And when I look at the priest and the temple assistant in this particular text, I see flavorless Christianity. I see people who have lost their witness. Now imagine if we were all up in the stands on the side of the mountain and we were watching this situation unfold. Imagine if we're all up there standing like we're in the movie theater, right, watching the movie, and down before us we see this particular situation where a Jewish man is going on the road and this group of bandits come along and they just mess his whole life up. They beat him half to death, take his clothes, and they leave him half dead on the side of the road. Right, imagine seeing that, and then imagine we see this priest come along. We'd all be like, surely that guy's going to take care of him. Surely he's going to go over there and help him. And then all of a sudden we see him walk over, see him laying in the ditch, and keep on going. You know what you would have? You would have been dumbfounded, because surely the religious guy, surely the priest, surely this guy would be the one you could count on. He's the one that stands up and he gives the word. He opens the scroll and he reads. This is the guy we know. He's the one that tells us the law, tells us what we're supposed to do, when we're supposed to do it, right? This is the guy. And he goes on, and we're left scratching our head. And then we see the temple assistant. This guy knows it as well. Here he comes. He walks over and he takes a good look. What's he do? He goes to the other side of the road, right? And now we're all left like, what is happening? Is nobody going to go and help this guy? They're just going to let him sit there and bleed. Flavorless Christians. You see, when I look at these two people, these two men, I see two figures that represent religion versus relationship. Religion versus relationship. Bad theology versus good theology. Head knowledge versus heart knowledge. And you know, the truth is, at some point, I think we've probably all maybe had a little bit of this in us. If we're honest, at times. Right? Because tell me we haven't been a little too busy, in too much of a hurry. Ah, it's too risky to stop and help that person. Ooh, I really don't know if I should do this or I shouldn't do that. You know what? Someone else will do it. I'm sure there's going to be somebody else coming along that's got more time than me, and I just know they'll do it. I've got my good clothes on. I can't stop and help that person. I might get a little dirt on my shoes. Ah, he's more bad. He's bad. He's worse than I can handle. Nothing I can do for that guy. What if something happens to me if I stop and help him? What do I really have to offer anyways? I mean, come on. There's times that we've been in this place. And you got to understand textually, the Bible tells us that they were going from Jerusalem to Jericho. Perhaps they had just finished their temple responsibilities. Perhaps they were there serving in the temple. They had finished their duties, and perhaps they were heading home. Perhaps they were done. So check out, check in. They saw it, moved on. Still had maybe the robes on. Who knows what this could have been defiled if I touched somebody like that. So it's interesting as we begin to see this. But I tell you what the story begins to reveal. Fakes. Counterfeit spirituality. Pseudo-relationship. People that got it on the outside, but not on the inside. Oh, yes, they do good things, but good things can be a checkoff sheet. Right? Good things can be my checkoff sheet. But when there's a real opportunity, isn't the priest and the temple person who we're really supposed to be? I mean, wasn't that the system of the day? Weren't they supposed to be the models? But didn't Jesus tell us about something? That they continue to heap more and more burden upon us. They create more and more disciples just like them. But they truly miss the deeper matters of spirituality. And Jesus is getting us to the heart. So I think about Mr. Rogers, won't you be my neighbor? And I think about what a neighbor is according to what Jesus tells me in my text here today. And I don't know how you've studied this passage. And I don't know if you know what I'm about to tell you, but Jesus is about to wreck some people's minds with what he tells here. Because when he finishes this portion of the story from the religious priest to the temple assistant, he describes the individual that helps him as the despised Samaritan. And I intentionally had you repeat that with me. Because the individual who had been beaten and robbed and left for dead was a Jew. It was a Jew. Jews were supposed to be the goody-two-shoes, the ones that had it all together. They were the elect, the chosen, the sons of Abraham. They were the ones to whom the promise was given. They were the ones, right? The Samaritans were not. The Samaritans, as I told you last week, were the half-breeds. They were the rejected ones. They were not to be a part of what God was doing. Because as I told you, go all the way back to the Babylonian captivity. Go all the way back to the release when Cyrus issued the decree and Ezra and Nehemiah and Zerubbabel, and they went back and they were going to rebuild the temple and they were going to rebuild the wall. Well, when they get there and they find all of this mess that's happening, these people were intermarrying, right? Well, a lot of the problems and things that had come up on the Jewish people were because of this kind of behavior. They were disobedient to God. And so the Jewish leaders said, you're not allowed to partake of what God is doing here. And they were pushed away and not allowed to be a part of it. And ever since then, there had been this tension between Samaritan and Jew. And this is why that the author describes the Samaritan as the despised Samaritan. You think about those in your community who are the despised of the community, because that's who we're talking about here. That's the one that went over to the individual and provided care. The despised in our community, the despised in our city, that's the one who was loving the neighbor like we should love our neighbor. Not all of the people in here that are supposed to be, it's the despised, the rejected, the outcast. That's the one that's providing this. And I think it's interesting because I don't want you to miss this. I don't want you to miss this. Being a neighbor for Jesus was not a matter of social status. It was not a matter of nationality or race. It had nothing to do with that. It had everything to do with the heart. Had nothing to do with convenience. Had nothing to do with my preferences. Had nothing to do with my timeline. It had nothing to do with my schedule. And it had everything to do with what's in Dusty's heart. What's in Dusty's heart? Loving my neighbor is an outflow of what's in my heart. And so don't miss this. Loving my neighbor like Jesus would have me to love my neighbor is what Jesus did. Think about it. Who did Jesus go to? One, he said that healthy people don't need a doctor, sick people do. He was hanging out with tax collectors, he was hanging out with prostitutes, he was hanging out with the outcast, the rejected, the poor, the leper. He was hanging out with everybody that nobody else wanted to hang out with. That was his crew. He went to the fishermen that didn't make the cut. He called the people that weren't smart enough, they didn't know enough of the religious law to make it to be a rabbi. They didn't get to come follow me until Jesus met them. This is the people that Jesus spent time with. That's Jesus' crew. That's Jesus' people. I told you, Jesus was a revolutionary. And in God's culture, it's different. It's not based on the social norms of the day. It's based on God's way of doing things. And in this particular moment, Jesus is confronting everything about what everybody is believing. Because the religious leader embodied that. See, this is all about Jesus going to Samaria to spend time with a Samaritan woman. Going to those that nobody else would have went to. Doing what nobody else wanted to do. And we talked about that, and I expounded upon that last week. But I mean, imagine sitting there this morning. Imagine sitting there and seeing the priest go over and take a look and just leave the man laying there. The Samaritans were the repulsive ones in the culture. Unrealistic burdens religious leaders put on people. And then a despised Samaritan comes over and loves in a way that confounds the ideologies of the day. Listen, if the church neglects loving our neighbors, we cease to be the church that Jesus has called it to be. I'm going to say it again. If the church, that is the people of God, the called out ones, the ecclesia, as the Bible tells us, you and I, we are the church, not a building with four walls. Hear this morning. The church was never built with four walls. The church was built with 2 feet. And we were called out of the world and sent back into the world to be revolutionaries, ambassadors, to love our city, to flavor the culture, to be the salt and the light of the world around us. We are not to be permeated with the culture, but we are to permeate the culture. And if the church neglects to love our community and love our neighbors, we cease to be the church that Jesus called us to be. Because he's called us for so much more. Come on, friends, he's called us for so, so much more. And I'm telling you, we may do many things, but the second commandment for his followers is to love our neighbor. The second commandment that he gave us, love your neighbor as yourself. We can't let buildings and services define our church. Come on, when Jesus said the gates of hell shall not prevail against the church, he was not referring to the temple, he was not referring to a building, but he was talking about you and I. The gates of hell will not prevail against me. When the enemy comes in like a flood, God will raise up a standard. Yet in all these things, I'm more than a conqueror through him who loves us. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. He didn't say greater is he that's in a building, greater is he that's in a temple. No, he said that we are more than conquerors, that the power of God that raised Jesus from the dead dwells within you and I. He said, you tear down that temple and I'll raise it back up in 3 days. Look, church, we are the church, and it's time that the church takes our community and we love our city the way that Jesus has called us to love our neighbor. We've got to get out there. We've got to flavor our culture. See, being a neighbor is all about action and it's not about knowledge. The Bible tells us, now which of these three would you say was a neighbor to the man who was attacked by bandits? And the man replied, the one who knew so much about the law, the one who could quote you the scriptures, the one who knew the answer right away. No. He said the one who demonstrated. He showed him mercy. I want to transition and shift. I've got a little video that we're going to put up here on the screen, and then I'm going to transition this message into something else.
good news about the kingdom will be preached throughout the whole world, so that all nations will hear it, and then the end will come. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses, telling people about me everywhere. For this is the reason that Jesus came, to seek and save those who are lost. Jesus came and told his disciples, I have been given all authority in heaven and on earth. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Teach these new disciples to obey all the commands I have given you. And be sure of this, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. For the one who wins souls is wise.
There was a time when Jesus was out walking around in his community. As he was walking the streets in his city, he looked here, and then he looked there. The Bible says he was moved with compassion. Why? Because the people that he saw were weighed down and they were burdened. And he said they were like sheep without a shepherd. And then he turns to his disciples and he tells them, the harvest is plentiful, but pray. You pray that the Lord would send laborers to join you in the work of reaching your community, reaching your city, going to the nations. And I can't help but be reminded of that moment that Isaiah the prophet had an encounter with God. And God said to Isaiah, who will I send? Who will go to the nations? Who will go into their community, their city? And Isaiah stood up and he said, I'll go, Lord. Here I am. Send me. And then I'm reminded of Matthew West's lyrics in that song that says, I'm just a nobody trying to tell everybody all about somebody that saved my soul. I got more I want to tell you about this.
You know, I think at this point, it's clear what God is calling us to do in loving our neighbor. And when I think about the future of the church, Gateway Church, what God has put in my heart as your pastor is that the church have two major focuses moving forward. One, that we focus on developing our internal ministries, that we continue to build up the body of Christ that's currently at Gateway, that we develop ministries and groups for people to come and be connected to. If we don't have anything in here to connect people to, it's hard to bring people into something. And so we develop ministries that would disciple people that are coming to the church. And then we focus on external ministries. Currently, this is the weakest area of Gateway Church. We are subpar when it comes to reaching our community. In fact, nationwide, this is one of the weak areas of many churches. In one of the senses, many millennials have been turned away from the church because they've seen the religious priest and they've seen the temple assistant, but they've not seen the despised Samaritan going out and loving their neighbor like they love themselves. They see a service and they see the hands raised, but they don't see change impacted in their community. And it becomes a turnoff, repulsive. It becomes a system. It becomes some structure, and we expect everyone to fit into it. You know, my wife and I have been here for a little over 6 years. In December, we will have been the lead pastor for 5 years. And as we have assessed and evaluated and prayed about Gateway Church, I can assure you that I rarely stop thinking about this particular place. When I lay my head on a pillow at night, there's not a night that goes by that I'm not thinking about this church. Not a night that goes by that I'm not thinking about the people of this church. There's not a day that goes by that I don't wake up thinking about people, praying for specific ones. You have probably been the recipient of just a random text out of nowhere, because the moment that God puts you on my heart, I'll send a text or I'll send a Facebook message. And you've probably been that person that said, you know, hey, just thinking about you today. Just sending you a message to let you know, hey, I'm praying for you. Hope all is well. Something along those lines. You say, why am I telling you that? Because I want to ask for your blessing, and I want to ask that the church come into unity to accomplish the what and the how of the future of our church. You with me this morning? So I want to read to you that particular passage that I quoted at the end of the video, Matthew chapter 9. And this has always just hit me in a certain kind of way. It says, when Jesus saw the multitudes, what's he saying there? When he was out and about in his city, as I told you in the video, he was walking here, he was walking there. When he saw the multitudes, he was moved with compassion because they were like sheep without a shepherd. He saw that they were confused and helpless. He didn't say, inside the temple, I saw what was happening and I was moved with compassion. Jesus was out and about in his community, and he saw there were people like this Jewish man that had been beaten and robbed and left for dead, and he saw that they needed a shepherd. You have neighbors, you know people that are like sheep without a shepherd. At times, I bet you felt like the Jewish man that was left for dead. Maybe you've not been physically beat up on, but I bet there's been battles that you faced that left you feeling like you were about to die on the side of the road, and everybody that should come and check on me isn't coming to check on me. And this is why the church has got to come together, because we begin to relegate or delegate just to two people to do all of the work. We just expect that the religious priest and the temple assistant should be the ones. When Jesus is opening our eyes and saying, there's more than just the pastoral staff to do the work of ministry. There's a whole congregation. And what if the whole congregation would go out into the community and find those who are like sheep without a shepherd and show compassion to them? What would the church really be like then? What if the church really unified to do these things? And as I have meditated and I have prayed and I have thought about all of the things that have been shared to me, all of the advice that has been given to me, and I come to a place that I want to share an illustration with you to try to help explain my efforts and energies and vision for what God has called us to do. How many parents do we have in here? So you'll get this. You got kids. When I think about the church, I think about what Jesus has told us about the church, that the church is a family. We are the family of God. We are the body of Christ. And when I look out across this room, I see diversity. I see different individuals. I see different demographics. Generationally, we are different. Gender, you are different. You all look different. And if you don't believe me, just come up here and take a look and see that y'all are different. Some of you are awake. Some of you aren't awake. Just messing. Come on, that was my little pause there to bring this to a close. In fact, Nate and Janelle, could you guys join me on the platform? But you know, imagine if you have a 3-month-old, imagine if you have a 9-month-old, and imagine if you have a college-age student, right? You've got a child who's a college student, they're in college. When you think about your time, effort, and energy, which one of those three is going to require the most time, effort, and energy? 3-month-old, right? The 3-month-old is going to require, they're at a different stage in life. They require a different kind of care, right? They're most likely either nursing from their mother or nursing from a bottle. You have to change them, dress them. Everything, the 3-year-old is dependent upon somebody to do something. But you know, when you've got a 9-year-old, at least you can send the 9-year-old and say, go get yourself dressed, brush your teeth, and so on and so forth. Right? It doesn't take as much time and effort and energy to get your 9-year-old ready. And if your college-age student still needs you to brush their teeth, still needs you to dress them, then we've got problems, but you get the point of the illustration. And when we look out at the church, I look at the demographic of the church. The strongest demographic of this church is the 50-plus group in the church. They have a community, a developed relationship. Spiritually speaking, they have been in church longer. They are faithful to support and give. They are at different places in their life. They have a pastor that's specifically over them. And when I think about that particular group, they're at a different stage in life and have different needs. Then when I look at the other demographics, and I begin to see that there's needs they have that the other group doesn't have. And so if you put me in the place of a spiritual parent, I have to look and say, this area needs my best effort and energy, because if I don't put it there, the infant's going to die. Are you with me? Does that make sense this morning? And so when I've looked at the the 40 and below group of the church, it's not that I didn't care about the 50 plus group. And it's not that I cared more for the 40 and under. It's I recognized if we don't do something to get this group up and going, there won't be a future of the church.
Wow.
So I've had to put my best efforts and energy into this, and I know it could be misunderstood. It could look like that it was something that it's not, because I assure you, I want to spend time with every group. You matter more to me than I think you know sometimes,
wow.
Right? And so I'm telling you this because I want you to know you matter, and I care. I do care about everyone that's in this room. But where I'm asking your blessing and your unity is that we all begin to recognize that there's a mother standing at the stove with the food on the stove. There's dishes in the sink. She's got one on her hip, and she's trying to multitask, making sure everything that's done. And we need to all come in and say, can I do the dishes?
Wow.
Can I come and set the table? Is there anything I can help do? See, it's a different mindset when we say, what can I do? What's the main focus right now? We want what's best for the church so that we can continue to reach people in this community long after Pastor Dusty and everybody else in this room is gone. Because we want to create an environment where Gateway Church continues to thrive and is effective 20, 30, 40, 50 years down the road. Because there were people 50 years ago that believed in the same thing. And many of the 50-plus group in this room believe in it. That's why you are faithful in your giving, faithful in your believing. And I'm just encouraging us in this room that we have got to come together as one body. And we've got to work together to do this. And there's something that I believe that God has placed on my heart. Now, I'm not going to say it's the end all, but I'm going to share the idea with you this morning in closing. And I'm going to give us an opportunity to respond. This is not something we're just going to jump in and do, but this is something that I want us to pray about, think about. I want to have more meetings and discuss, is this right, what Pastor Dusty believes in his heart? A friend of mine up in Denver, Colorado, he had started a ministry there, and they called it a donut truck. They had a donut trailer. And God had given him this idea that they would find a horse trailer. And they would convert this trailer. They were going to build it and create it, shape it, design it, where they could serve donuts to people in their community. And all they wanted to do was just get where the multitudes were. They wanted to find a way to connect with others, a way to just start a conversation, a way that they could just get out and give back to the community, a way to just get out there and serve. No strings attached. We're here just to love you, because I remind us, that's exactly what Jesus did. He always did for those who would never be able to do in return like he did for them. That's what the despised Samaritan did. He never expected that Jewish person to ever do anything back for him. He simply did out of the goodness of his heart. And that's what I think the church is losing. And so this idea of developing some kind of a food trailer truck would be a place for us to go out and serve, to pull our trailer up into the park and just go out and give donuts away. Or we could serve food, or we could go down to the police station and serve the police station. They would do special things where they'd go over to a school and they would theme out a donut, whatever the school was, and they'd serve the teachers. They'd do things for the kids. Anytime there was an event in their community, they would pop up and there the donut trailer would be. And they would just serve, and they would just love. They'd pass out information about their church. They'd talk about these things. And it works. And, you know, one of the people that is there doing that very thing grew up in this church. How many of you are familiar with the name Caleb Slocum? Somebody over there is, for sure. That's his church. That's where he's at. He knows all about this ministry. And when I had talked to Preston, who used to be the church plant pastor there, he's like, when you guys are ready, if this is what God's leading you to do, you know, Caleb could come home, and I know Nina's like, get him, be good, right? But it could help talk about this as we dream and think. The staff and I, we were dreaming, and we were talking about we could take this trailer, we could go down and serve the homeless, we could have pop-up services, we could partner with Teen Challenge and connect and do these kind of things. We could do so many things with this. We could raise money for missions with it. But the biggest thing is we could get outside the four walls of this building and go where people are and start having conversations about where people are at in life and let them know that somebody's thinking about them. Somebody loves them. Wow. Here's a donut. Wow. Who knows? Who knows what God may do through something like this? Who knows how God, this may not even be exactly it, but this is a starting place to have a discussion for how we get outside of the four walls and go where Jesus is calling us to go. And this is what I want to ask us to do. You've heard my heart on this, and I don't want to just continue to go and go and go, and I could because I think about this stuff all day long. But if you're interested in doing what God is calling us to do, external ministry focusing on the community, internal ministry focusing on what God is, I'm just going to ask you to be willing to stand and say, I want to be a good neighbor. If you're willing to be a part of what God is doing, if you want to be a part of this, I want God's will. The next thing I'm going to ask us to do is that if you want to be a part of this, I'm going to ask you to come and just gather around the altars. Just pack in up here, just as a step of faith. We're coming to that place where we're going to make a commitment to Jesus as a church together. Because maybe God is going to be calling some of you to help and partner with us financially. Maybe God's going to birth a dream in you. Maybe you're going to be part of a building team, a serving team. I don't know what God's going to do. I really don't. I don't have it all figured out. I'm telling you that. But I know that when we come before God and say like Isaiah said, here I am, Lord, send me. I know that God turned the world upside down with 12 people. And I know there's a whole lot more than 12 people in this room. Yeah? I'm going to throw you a curveball, Jamil, but I think you know this song because your family wrote it. If you can use anything, Lord, use me. You know that one?
You can use anything, Lord. You can use me. Oh. If you can use anything, Lord, you can use me. Take my hands, Lord. Touch my heart, Lord, and speak to me. If you can use anything, Lord, you can use me. If you can use anything, Lord, you can use me.
This last time that we sing it, can we sing it as our altar call prayer? Can we just make that song, those lyrics, our prayer? God's not asking anymore. God's not asking you to just say, here I am. If you can use me, Lord, whatever that may be. That's the prayer of a servant. That's the prayer. That's the action when the most powerful man in the room stood up to wash his disciples' feet. That's what he did. Let's sing it one more time as we close.
Take my hand, Lord, and my feet.
Jesus, Jesus. This is what I love about your people, that they're willing to do what you're asking them to do. God, may I lead the way in being obedient and humble before you. May I be like the despised Samaritan, never too busy, never too good, never too clean, never know too much. But may we love our neighbor as you've called us to do. I pray a spirit of unity over this church, spirit of power to come over the church. God, I pray that we would begin to reach one more for you, God. That God, the ministries within the house of Gateway would be strong and vibrant, and that each day we'd give one more piece of our life away to the day that we come to stand before you and hear those words that we all long for. Well done, my good and faithful servant. May your blessing be upon this work. God, may we have the wisdom of Christ as we seek to find your will in these matters. In Jesus' name, amen. Let me say this to you because I want you to hear it. I'm not saying I have all the answers, but I know that when we ask the Lord for the wisdom, he'll give it to us. And I think that these ideas are a starting place for all of us to work together as one people, right, to do what God has called us to do. Amen? Amen.
Thank you for watching today's message. I hope it blessed and encouraged you. Click like and subscribe to our YouTube channel. And let me encourage you, consider giving to support the ministries of Gateway Church. You can do that by texting 77977 and then put GW Shreve in the text box. Also, download our app in the App Store, Gateway Church Shreveport. Share this with your friends, and we'll look forward to seeing you next week.